Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to speak essentially on growth disorders and hormonal response. Now, my title says this. I'm going to briefly cover growth hormone deficiencies, the various stimulation tests required in growth hormone deficiencies, a brief about congenital adrenal hyperplasia and thyroid function test in newborns from a pediatric perspective. Before we actually start with stimulation tests, let us have a look at the basis of growth hormone regulation. Like all of us already know, growth hormone is secreted from hypothalamus in response to GnRH, which acts on the pituitary to cause release of growth hormone. This acts on the fatty acids in the form of acts on the adipose tissue and cause storage of free fatty acids. It acts on the liver to cause generation and release of IGF-1. And now we also know that there is a hormone called as ghrelin released from the stomach, which has a role to play in your nutrition, which indirectly affects your growth. Negative feedback is because of somatostatin released from hypothalamus and also excess of free fatty acids, which have a negative feedback at pituitary as well as hypothalamic levels. So a lot of neuropeptides and neuroregulators have a role to play in stimulation as well as inhibition of growth hormone release, which is the basic principle of various pharmacological tests done for growth hormone estimation. Growth hormone secretion is stimulated by multiple factors, including sleep, exercise, physical stress, fasting, and hypoglycemia, and is inhibited by high glucose levels, high glucocorticoids, and uncontrolled hypothyroidism. Extremely busy slide, but I'll just be very brief with this. GH deficiency could either be as an isolated condition or a part of multiple pituitary hormone deficiency. The etiology of could be genetic because of various hormonal defects or genetic defects, acquired essentially because of CNS lesions, or idiopathic, where you have congenital absence of pituitary or for something like a septo-optic dysplasia, which ultimately leads to multiple pituitary hormone deficiencies. Or it could be in isolation, where we have actually a growth hormone deficiency, which would have other associations and present as syndromes. Or it could be growth hormone insensitivity, where GH is normal but cannot act because of defective level of receptor, for example, Laron's syndrome. What are the various clinical features of GH deficiency? Essentially, these children are born with a normal birth weight and slightly smaller in height. They have central obesity, short stature, typical rounded face, frontal bossing, open anterior allies, classically have micro penis in boys. They also have delayed dentition and poor eruption of teeth. This is a girl who is 9 years old and a brother who is 7 years old. They absolutely look infantile because of familial growth hormone deficiency. This is a boy who is 15 years old and his brother who is 12. They have no secondary sexual characters developed. They also have high-pitched voice, another feature of growth hormone deficiency. Other associations could be a single central incisors, cleft palate or cleft lip, which could be an indicative of a growth hormone deficient condition. This is what I was talking about, Laron's syndrome, where you have growth hormone insensitivity. These are extremely short children, even shorter than classical growth hormone deficiency. These are two siblings, age 4 and 2 years, who are extremely short for their ages. So when you have a child of growth hormone deficiency, how do we start? The consensus statement given by the Growth Hormone Society has given us oxological criteria which we have to meet. In addition to that, they give us certain clinical conditions in which we should suspect growth hormone deficient situations. For example, in a neonate with hypoglycemia, prolonged physiological jaundice or micropenis, when there is history of clinical irradiation, conditions which have CNS tumors or CNS infections, or when we have midline defects, we should suspect a patient with growth hormone deficiency. But what we are interested mainly as pediatricians is this, the oxological criteria to diagnose growth hormone deficiency. Essentially means the child is extremely short. How short? Less than 3 standard deviations for his gender and age as per the local centiles. His height velocity is extremely poor, less than 2 standard deviations over a period of 1 year, or less than 1.5 standard deviation lower over a period of 2 years. So a child who is extremely short, just to remember broadly, less than 2 centiles below the average, with poor growth velocity of less than 25th centile, should be considered or investigated for growth hormone deficiency. In addition to lab parameters, which I'm going to discuss shortly, we can think about radiological tests to confirm the diagnosis of growth hormone deficiency, which could be due to CT scan and MRI. When you do a CT scan, we're basically interested in conditions like craniopharyngiomas, which affect growth, and MRI, which would give us a typical pituitary picture, which can be helpful in diagnosis of growth hormone deficiency. This is a child who came to us with GH deficiency-like picture, and when the MRI showed us a large tumor in the brain, turned out to be a craniopharyngioma. Similarly, MRI in MPHD is a triad of classical three things: small antepituitary, missing pituitary stalk, and ectopic posterior pituitary, that is ectopic bright spot. This is a classical picture where we have empty serratashika and ectopic posterior pituitary in the form of a bright spot. Okay, so now we have the axological criteria, we have the radiological picture. What can we do about the lab findings? The lab findings can be taken into two groups. One is a screening test, another one is a definitive test. The screening test essentially include IGF-1 levels and IGF BP3, that is insulin-like growth factor binding protein levels. These are surrogate markers for diagnosing growth hormone deficiency. IGF-1 and BP3 have or are growth hormone dependent, and hence these levels would probably help us to diagnose growth hormone deficiency. But they are not with their own drawbacks. IGF-1 levels vary with nutrition. So in extremely small children, below 2 years of age, doing only IGF-1 will be of no help or will not be of a diagnostic importance. Similarly, IGF-BP3 also has a non-specific role, but it is less affected by nutrition. And hence, if you do these two tests together, one can have a predictable value by doing IGF-1 and BP3 together to diagnose growth hormone deficiency. Definitive test, obviously growth hormone stimulation test. Because they're cumbersome, certain centers have recommended use of spontaneous measurement of growth hormone secretion over a period of 12 to 24 hours. Very difficult to do, no longer recommended, and not done in many, many centers. But what we do is growth hormone stimulation tests. Fine. Now we have a child who is short. How do you approach this child? First, we start with the orthological criteria, which we discussed just now. A height, less than 300 deviation with a poor growth velocity. We did a screening test in the form of IGF-1 and BP3 levels. Both were low. So now we go to the growth hormone stimulation test. So when we do the test, what are the various aspects which one should understand and address in the response to growth hormone stimulation test? What is the basic principle of doing this test? When to do and when not to do these tests? How to interpret the results and how to analyze the results when they come? Let us start with the basic principle. Growth hormone is released in the pulsatile form. There are about 4 to 6 pulses per day. And hence, if we do a single growth hormone stimulation value, it will be of no help. And that is why we need a stimulated value of growth hormone to know the growth hormone deficiency.